So we have seen belt drive, basics of belt drive, how to find out the length of the belt. Now let us see how to arrive at the power that is transmitted by a belt drive. So we already know that first we will write down to find power transmitted. To find out the power that is transmitted by a belt drive. So for that to understand, suppose I draw a standard belt drive like this. And see, this is a driver and it's driven. That means this is a tight side. Now the tensions in the sides, it is shown like this. This is T1, this is T2. T1 is tension in tight side, which is in newtons. Tension is a force. The force in this particular side is higher than force on this side, because it's a tight side, it's a slack side. You can see a slack. Is it tight? So tight side tension is shown by T1, and T2 is tension in slack side, again measured in newtons. So if this is the value of tensions, then how do we find out the power that is transmitted? That is the next thing. Now as you know, here the belt is moving means it has got certain velocity V. So V is equal to the belt velocity, say in meters per second. Now in general, power is measured in watts, and power is made up of force into velocity. Force is in newtons, velocity is in meters per second. So if you have got a force and a velocity, then the multiplication gives you power, which is in watts. Now in this case, there is a force in newtons. So the belt is carrying certain force and it is moving with certain velocity. So that is constituting certain power. So the power in this case, power transmitted already here. Power transmitted is given by force. Now in this case, force is the net difference. On one side is T1, other side is T2. So the difference between the two tensions, that is the total force. So the total force is T1 minus T2. The force that is existing in the belt is T1 minus T2. And then multiply this by the belt velocity V. That becomes the power in watts. Now what is V? V is the linear velocity. So we can convert that linear velocity is equal to V, which is equal to radius into angular velocity. Angular velocity here and radius. And what is angular velocity? Omega is in radians per second. So how do we convert radians per second into RPM? See, it is like this. One rotation or one revolution is corresponding to 2 pi radians. So when it says W radians, means it is rotating by W radians in 1 second. So W radians and RPM you have to now convert. So suppose it is rotating by n RPM. So n RPM means n revolutions per minute. That means n revolutions in 60 seconds. And one revolution is taking 2 pi. So n revolutions is taking 2 pi into n, this is radians in 60 seconds. So now radians per second means this is omega. So omega radians per second is 2 pi n by 60. So I'll write here omega is equal to 2 pi n by 60. This is a conversion of omega into n. So here if we write omega, then it becomes, instead of v, we write v equal to r omega. Instead of that, we write this. So this conversion gives us, I'll write maybe here, power p is equal to t1 minus t2. And instead of v is r omega, so instead of omega, we'll write r into omega is 2 pi n by 60. So 2 pi n by 60. Now what is t1 minus t2 into r? T1 minus t2 is force. Force into r is torque. So we'll say that it is t, and then I'll write 2 pi n first. So 2 pi n by 60 into t, that is power. This becomes the important equation what we want. So the power that is transmitted is given by 2 pi n t by 60, where n is the rotational speed in RPM, and then t is the torque at this particular wheel. Torque is made up of, I'll write here, t is torque, and this is equal to difference in forces into the radius. Force, this is a difference in the force, that is net force, you can say. Net force is T1 minus T2 acting on the pulley, and that force is at a distance of r. So force into r is torque, so 2 pi n by torque, so 2 pi n t by 60, that is the power. So the power transmitted for a belt drive is given by 2 pi n by 60, where n is the speed in RPM, which you can measure by tachometer. Tachometer is a device which you can fit here at the axis, and that device will sense the rotational speed in RPM. So that will give you the speed, and then T stands for torque. So that is how the power is found out. For measuring torque, there are some other devices which we will be learning afterwards. They are called as dynamometers. So with the help of dynamometers, you can measure torque, then you can measure speed by tachometers, and then you will be able to find out the power that is present at the shaft of a belt drive. So that is power transmitted for a belt drive. This is how the entire work is. So you can maybe jot this down as a write-up for finding out the power transmitted for a belt drive. Okay, so now let us continue further. We have found out how to find out the power that is transmitted by a belt drive. Now for getting this value, as you have seen here, earlier we have written one equation. T1 minus T2 into R, etc., etc. So first thing now is to find out the ratio of tensions which is required. So let us find out, to find the ratio of tensions, write it later, to find out ratio of tensions for a flat belt drive. Okay, so now what we have drawn here is, we have drawn one of the two pulleys. So there is some power transmission taking place. This is a pulley, this is a belt, maybe there is one more pulley here. And the belt is going like this. So we have drawn only this much part, where the pulley is shown and the belt is shown. And initially this is a tight side, T1, higher tension, T2, lesser tension. Now the belt is in contact with pulley for angle theta. From this point to this point, it is in contact, afterwards it is not in contact. Then what we do is, out of this much part in contact, we have taken a very small segment, very small segment, which is covering angle, very small angle delta theta. So instead of saying full theta, only small angle is covered by this small segment. Now we are trying to find out what are the forces acting on this small segment. So I will draw this small segment here again, which is covering angle equal to delta theta. So this same figure I am drawn again here. This is a horizontal line, and now what we have shown is that the tension on this side and on this side. So here it is T plus delta T, and here it is T, because on this side the tension is higher, this side the tension is low. So we say that the tension on this side, if it is T, then the tension on this side is slightly higher, T plus delta T. So in this particular condition, what happens is the belt is pulled by tensions on both sides, and the pulley is resisting. See, the belt is not coming down. Why it is not coming down? Because of the pulley here. Resting on pulley. It is a resting on pulley means what? Pulley is supporting the belt. That means it is exerting a force in the vertical direction. So this is the upward direction force that is exerted as Rn. So Rn is normal reaction by pulley on belt. So the belt segment is under the action of total three forces. This particular segment is pulled in this direction by T plus delta D. In this direction it is pulled by tension T, and upwards it is given support by the pulley. So pulley is exerting force Rn upwards. So under the action of these three forces, the belt is in equilibrium. Right here, belt is in equilibrium. Therefore, the three forces, I'll draw the three forces. Like this. So this is T, this force, upward is Rn, and this is T plus delta D, and this angle is delta theta. So approximately these three forces, they are forming a closed triangle. That means they are in the balanced condition, that is why it is in equilibrium. So if this is the case, then we write that Rn is equal to T plus delta T into delta theta. Angle is delta theta. So when you multiply this inside, this will be T delta theta plus delta T delta theta. Now delta T delta theta is a very small figure, because both are small, so this is neglected. So that gives us Rn is equal to Rn is equal to T plus delta theta. The normal reaction Rn is equal to T plus delta theta. That comes as a part of derivation. Now let us see what happens next. Let us find the components of these forces. So here, see, this angle is delta theta. How much is this angle? This is delta theta by 2. This is going to be delta theta by 2. If you solve the geometry, you will come to know that this comes out to be delta theta by. Now, at the moment what happens is, the belt is having tension on this side T1, tension on this side is T2. So therefore, see, it is rotating in this direction. So as a result, there is a frictional force acting. I will show it, say, here, like this. This is a frictional force, mu into Rn, in this direction. that force is acting on the belt like this. So now what we do is we are finding out the equilibrium by considering the forces in the horizontal direction. So on that side, see, it is like this. I'll draw it, the forces like this. This is T plus delta T cos of delta theta by 2, that means this component, cos component. On this side it is T cos delta theta by 2, and there is one more force, that is the mu rn. So now if we write the equation, we will have to write like this: T plus cos delta theta by 2 plus mu rn is equal to, on this side, T plus delta T cos of delta theta by 2. Now cos of this delta theta by 2 is very small, so it is almost 0, so cos theta will be 1. So this is like 1. So this becomes a term 1. This T cos. So this is 1. So this becomes T plus mu rn is equal to, on this side it is T plus delta T. So delta T, delta T gets cancelled. So we are left with mu into rn equal to delta T. Now rn is T delta theta. So I'll write this rn here. So it comes as mu into T delta theta, that is rn, equal to delta T. So now I'll continue maybe here. So we'll take T on one side and other things on the other side. So it comes as mu delta theta is equal to delta T upon T. Mu delta theta is delta T upon T. So that is all for the small segment. But in reality, the belt is coming in contact from this much. So it is covering angle, not delta theta, but theta. That means we have to integrate this segment. We have to integrate up to this limit. So when you put integration sign here, I'll write here, mu integration of delta theta is equal to integration of delta T T. And the angle, when the angle is 0, the tension is T2. And when the angle is theta, the tension is T1. So now when you integrate, integration of delta theta is theta. So this is mu theta. And when you take integration here, it becomes, that comes as log of T1 upon T2. Log to the base E of T1 upon T2. That is integration of dt upon t. So therefore, I'll write here t1 upon t2 is equal to e raised to mu theta. So this is the derivation what we were looking for. So to find out the ratio of tensions for a belt drive, for a flat belt drive, this answer came as t1 upon t2 is equal to e raised to mu theta. This is a derivation what we have derived here. Ratio of tensions is given by e raised to mu theta, where mu is the coefficient of friction between the belt and the pulley here, and theta is the angle of lap in radians. Of course, this angle is always in radians. Is in radians. C. So ratio of tensions is given by this expression. From where this mu rn has come? Because the force, normal force is like this. So the frictional force is this way. So that is how we are getting mu rn this way along the direction of tangent. Okay, so that becomes the ratio of tensions for a flat belt drive. Now the next derivation will be for V belt drive. Right now we are understanding only up to this much. Okay, so remember this formula. We are going to use this formula for the solving of problems for finding out power transmitted, etc., etc. This formula is most important. This is ratio of tensions.